the burden of sin. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you believe the victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood.
Just stop there for a moment. I wasn't watching my cheat, and I did the second song first.
That's what I thought. I thought you did.
I had everybody mixed up today. I was so excited to get the power in the blood.
Oh, yeah.
Woo! Hey, but let's start with, are you washed in the blood? How about that?
Oh,
very well. Here we go. You lead it, Tony. You lead it.
And been to Jesus for the cleansing power. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they washed? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? Soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin. Are we washed in the blood of the Lamb? There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Would you be free from your burden? Sin. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. Where there's power, would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's side. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sins in the lost in this life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood. There is power.
find out the name of your neighbor so you can pray for him by name later.
Morning, neighbor. We know Clay. Andrew and Zach.
I don't know that guy.
Just kidding.
It is good to see everybody today. You can have a seat for just a moment. I apologize for the mess up at the beginning that just knows to all of us here that none of us here are perfect. And if we claim to be, well, we need to make a mistake every now and then to show that we're not. Okay. In your bulletin is a connection card. And please fill that out, and you can put it on the table back there where you came in to the auditorium where you picked up your communion. If you haven't yet picked up your communion, you're welcome to do so at any time. And we want to thank everybody again who's been working on the empty tomb out there. It's come into shape, isn't it? And so, Jerry, any announcements on that?
Next Saturday, be here at 9.
Next Saturday, be here at 9. All right. A new class began this morning. It's a basics class, and if anybody wants to be a part, just the basics of the faith of following Jesus, and Steve's leading that class, and he said, man, we had a terrific class this morning. All right, so free. Oh, free. Any coffee?
We ain't got coffee.
Well, good, I'll come then. Oh, yeah. All right. Beginnings Care for Life. There are the baby bottle campaign is this month. You can get your baby bottle, put change in through the month. We'll turn those in at the end of the month. And on October 1st, as a matter of fact. And then tomorrow night is the steak and shrimp dinner down at the camp. It's $18 for adults and no? Yeah. Yep. That's correct, and $12 for 12 and under. So if you're interested in going, let Tony know.
Okay, so the people who live south of town, we will be meeting here at 5 o'clock. So those of you who live the south side of town, we're meeting here at 5, and then we will be going over to Jeff's, and we'll leave in Jeff's at 5:15. Yeah. Several of us that live just south of town, it's easier just to go here.
North of town.
North of town, sorry. This is north.
Yes.
Those of us who live north of town, meet here at 5, and we'll go to Jeff's, and 5:15 we'll leave from Jeff's place.
All right, very good.
Yes.
Park in the Kellogg parking lot, Kellogg Community College parking lot. Lots of parking
question.
There. Yes, Carol.
No time on the fall banquet.
Fall banquet. October the 12th. We'll get there when we get closer. Get the date, but I can't tell you what time. General, Letha, what time's the Beginnings Care banquet start in October? 5:30. All right, good. There's an answer for us right there. There is an open house on the 16th at the Beginnings. It's a once-a-year thing, open house, from 1 to 3 on the 16th. And apple dumplings will be served. I bet you those are free too, Steve. Yeah. And then the treats that we're taking to Trine University happens on the 26th. Look in your bulletin for more info. And then there's a ladies' retreat coming up at the camp in October. And as well as WINGS, our ladies' group here at the church, is sponsoring the second annual Ladies' Day here on October 21st. And Kim Butts is the speaker. She and her husband were headed up the prayer ministry in Terre Haute in Indiana. Dave passed away last year, but she's going to come and really encourage. That's something that you ladies will definitely want to be a part of. So a lot of details and so forth in the bulletin. We get each other's names so that when we get to our prayer time, we'll start it out by praying for each other by name so that each of us can know that we are before the throne of God by name. So with that, I'll turn it over to Tony, for scripture reading.
Let's all stand this morning, and as we read from God's word, we're reading from Psalm 63, starting at verse 1. Oh God, you are my God. I earnestly search for you. My soul thirsts for you. My whole body longs for you in this parched and weary land where there is no water. I have seen you in your sanctuary and gazed upon your power and glory. Your unfailing love is better than life itself. How I praise you. I will praise you as long as I live, lifting up my hands to you in prayer. You satisfy me more than the richest feast, and I will praise you with songs of joy. Let's continue to worship the Lord this morning.
God, I'm running for your heart, I'm running for your heart, till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways, I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire, till I am a soul on fire. God, I'm running for your heart, I'm running for your heart, till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways, I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire, till I am a soul on fire. Lord, restore the joy I had. I have wandered, bring me back. In this darkness, lead me through, until all I see is you. God, I'm running for your heart, I'm running for your heart, till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways, I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire, till I am a soul on fire. Lord, let me burn for you again. I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm running for your heart, I'm running for your heart, till I am a soul on fire, till I am a soul on fire, till I am a soul on fire.
To age, he stands.
my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior.
You may be seated.
Good morning. I'm going to be reading a little bit. I got this out of the Christian Standard. It's kind of an interesting little meditation. G.K. Chesterton wrote a series of short stories featuring Father Brown, a little priest with amazing discernment and wisdom. He solves crimes and other puzzling situations easily. He dispenses wisdom freely. These are fascinating stories. In Father Brown's Secret, the cleric explains how he solves the mysteries that regularly come his way. The priest says he imagines himself as the perpetrator of the crime, and that reveals the solution. When someone in the story objected that he could not carry out such evil, the priest observes that no man can know how good he can be until he understands how bad he can be. What a profound insight. We like to imagine ourselves as upright and competent, and who doesn't? We know, of course, that we all have faults. We understand that we aren't perfect. We may find it prudent to confess we have sinned. But deep down, too, we often see ourselves as pretty good people. And our imaginations get in the way of a real encounter with God. Until we know how sinful we are in God's eyes, we will never be able to be as good as God wants us to be. The Lord's Supper is a built-in reminder. To approach this table and leave with spiritual health and vitality, we must encounter the reality of sin. It was sin, our sin, that offended God. It was our sin that sent Jesus to the cross. It was our sin that demanded a sacrifice to atone for it. Coming to this table is a stark reminder of how sinful we really are. But this table also reminds us of how valuable we are and what we can be because of Jesus Christ. We are reminded of the truth of Romans 8:37 through 39. We are more than conquerors through him who loved us, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So it's through Jesus that we are truly good. It's nothing that I have done or you have done, any of us done. We're sinners, man, and we need Jesus. Amen. And that's why we're meeting around this table, to remember what he did on that cross for us. So I'm going to say a prayer, and then I want you to meditate for a little bit, and then you can partake on your own. Heavenly Father, we come before you, and we all acknowledge that we are sinners. And it doesn't matter how much good we do. It just doesn't cut it. But we're good because of Jesus Christ. And that's how you see us. You see us through your Son. And Father, we're so thankful that he hung on that cross, Lord, and he shed his blood. And I just can't even imagine the the pain and the agony and the things that he went through, just so I have that choice, that promise of eternal life in heaven with you. Lord, I just pray that you would bless this loaf and bless this cup that you have given us to remember the sacrifice that Jesus did for us. For it's in your Son's holy name I pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. Today's mission moment is Great Lakes Christian College. Did you know that GLCC now has a compassionate care program with a curriculum that supplies 90% of the prerequisites of most colleges' nursing and allied health programs? After earning an associate or bachelor's degree at GLCC, students will be able to complete an RN or BSN at a wide variety of other schools in 16 months or less. The program is designed to deliver a rich blend of Bible science, humanities, psychology, ethics, and communication. Pray that the students who complete this program will be able to reach out and encourage patients to feel God's love. Let us pray for Great Lakes Christian College. Lord, young people are the future of the church, and we pray for every student that goes there, Lord, that they would be the new leaders and do solemn work for you, Father. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You remember the name of your neighbor? We're going to be praying for each other. So important that we pray for each other. Because the Lord knows what's happening this week, doesn't he?
Amen.
And God's at work. So let's bow our heads and let's pray. Pray for one another. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth I will make known your faithfulness, Lord, through all generations. I will declare that your love stands forever and that you have established your faithfulness in heaven above. Lord, we thank you for being Jehovah Rapha, our healer. And we pray, Lord, for your healing to be among us today, spiritual healing, physical healing, emotional healing. healing that needs to happen among relationships, healing with finances. Lord, we know that you know all that our lives consist of, where we're weak, where we're strong, what our needs are today and in this coming week. And so, Lord, you are also our provider. And so, Lord, we praise you this morning because you do provide for us. Perhaps even all of us have recognized how at certain times in our life you have provided for us even miraculously. We didn't know how something was going to happen, how some provision was going to be made. And yet your faithfulness to us, Lord, is revealed once again when you make the way when there seems to be no way. So, Lord, we thank you that all of us can place our lives into your hands. Lord, that we can walk confidently into this week because we know that you are with us and we have brothers and sisters in our church fellowship that we're praying for each other, not only today, but in the days to come, and you hear our prayers. We pray, Lord, for our county, that you would breathe upon this county, that thousands and thousands of people, Lord, would hunger and thirst for righteousness, even though they may not even be thinking about it at the moment. Lord, your mighty hand can move across not only this county, but across our state and across this land. Help us as your people, Lord, to be the tools in your hands. Perhaps we'll be the breath that you use to speak to someone about the love of God. How great and precious, Lord, is your love and your forgiveness. Thank you for the work that you've done for us. We pray for our co-workers around the world, Lord, that you would sustain them today. Put a mighty blessing on their services as they meet in the name of Jesus. Lord, help us to grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Help us, Lord, to grow more intense in our motivation, Lord, in following you, in serving you. Lord, you have a reason and a purpose, and you have raised us up for such a time as this in human history, that you would use us for your purposes. And Lord, may your purposes be achieved. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Good to see everybody today. Glad to be here.
Amen.
All right, me too. Without a doubt, looking back over the last 3 years, we but even in the world, turned a corner in 2020. There was a seismic shift that has happened. The door has been opened for the political Marxists that are in power to implement strategies in our culture towards socialism. We must see the various actions that have happened all across our nation, not as independent things. Well, this happened there and this is happening there, and it seems like there's no connection between them all, but there is. They all tie together towards a plan that has been being implemented for years. And we're going to, in the next few weeks, we're going to look at several of these things. Why? For the very purpose that Jesus declared, that we would be prepared for the last days. The Lord wants us prepared. He doesn't want us wondering or unaware. And most of all, he wants us to live in the triumph of the gospel. He doesn't want us to be discouraged or depressed or overwhelmed with things that happen in culture. I'm going to mention at the end of the message, but this last Wednesday, we watched a first part of a three-part video that showed how that the fastest growing church is in, of all places, Iran, which, well, is just amazing in and of itself. I'm not going to go down that rabbit trail right now. But the scriptures give us a lot of information, folks, about the last days. Jesus said in some parables, be ready, be prepared. My question to us this morning is, do you feel ready? Do you know that you're prepared for these things, to approach them in a godly way? I mean, in God's way, are we ready for that? I hope that we can do that as we think through some of these things. Jesus called the time to come after he left. He said, these are the last days. So since Jesus left and went back to heaven, we've been in the last days. But there's also what we call the last days, when we know the final events that Jesus pointed to are going to happen. And guess what? We're a whole lot more close to them now than we were when Jesus left. In Matthew chapter 24, you will want to read that this week. Matthew chapter 24, if you need to write that down, write it down. Matthew chapter 24. Jesus told us many things about the last days in that chapter. In the Old Testament, we have a lot of information about the last days. And we especially have the descriptions that the Holy Spirit gave to Paul and to Peter and to Jude. And then, of course, the revelations that the Spirit gave to John that were written down in the book of Revelation. Now, during these times in which we live, how many of you all have heard a talk about signs of the times? Signs, you know, we hear that talk. We recognize certain signs of the times that we find in Scripture. What the pandemic did in 2020 was reveal. It revealed a lot of things that had been happening underneath the surface, but now it bubbled up to the surface and we can see it for what it is. The implementation of ungodly philosophies that have been impacting our world, that are really in a big way impacting our world and our country, and we are not to see these incidents that we see happening across our land as isolated incidents or random misfortunes. They are connected. It is a part of a master plan. And when you connect the dots, you can see that we are speeding down the racetrack to the end of history, the last days. There have been worse days in human history, such as World War I and World War II and you know, various civil wars that have happened throughout history. And there have been times, you know, we tend to say, I hear, boy, we're really living in bad times, but I can guarantee you it can get a whole lot worse. We haven't seen but the tip of the iceberg of what can come. But what we do see right now is we see the storm clouds gathering, don't we? Paul wrote this. This is important. Colossians 2:4, and then I'm going to read Colossians 2:8. Listen to this. He said, I'm telling you these things so that no one may deceive you by fine-sounding arguments. Let me tell you, folks, there's a lot of fine-sounding arguments that can be heard these days. Verse 8, Paul writes, see to it. Oh, this is going to take effort on your part, right? Not just your preacher's part. This is going to take some effort on your part. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the basic principles of this world, rather than on Christ. So that Paul makes that distinction. There's the philosophies that we hear in the world, and he calls them empty and hollow. And then you have Christ, which he also says in verse 3, all the knowledge of the world, all everything can be found in Christ. So you have hollow and empty philosophies, and you have Christ. Folks, Jesus Christ is the answer for the last days. And your relationship with him is going to determine whether you are prepared or unprepared. And so ask yourself the question, am I prepared in my relationship with Jesus to face anything that's to come? Are you there yet? And if you're not, then you know what kind of work you need to do. And that's one of the reasons why I'm wanting to do this series. Jesus Christ is the answer. Now, Oliver Anthony released a song a few weeks ago. How many of you have heard it? Okay, if I say Rich Men North of Richmond, now how many of you have heard it? Have you heard that song? I am really surprised. There's a smattering of you. I've heard it. It went viral. It was released a month ago. It went viral overnight. I checked it last night. There were 61 million views. Hardly in recent history has anything, well, in recent history we have YouTube. But anyway, it's just gone crazy. And what the song is, it's a lament of our current times. So I'm going to summarize it. It's a lament. I spent a lot of time thinking about this because I've listened to the song a lot. And yeah, there's some bad words in the song. But it is a depiction of what people are feeling, right? And they're lamenting what is the world, the way it is. He says, it's a shame what the world's gotten to for people like me and people like you. Wish I could just wake up and it not be true. But it is. Oh, it is. I'm living in a new world with an old soul. What a phrase to be turned. The song is a lament that people all over the world are experiencing. Did you know that the scriptures have laments in it? David in the Psalms laments. Many of his songs in the book of Psalms are laments. Matter of fact, there's even a book in the Bible called Lamentations. What is Lamentations? Five songs of lament of the way things are. It's what they are. And laments can be good because they can bring about change. They show what is, and people know we want change. I guess I'll say it this way. The problem with Oliver Anthony's song is that it's just a lament. There's no answers. There's no answers in the song. Just it's a lament. But it's good because has it struck a chord. It has struck a chord and people are vibrating with it. People inherently know. In the world, people who are not spiritual, people inherently know that things could be different than what they are, but they don't have answers. So there is a war against God and his creation and his people. And this war is described in the scriptures. And matter of fact, Jesus said there would be wars and rumors of wars that are going to lead up to the last days, in which there's going to be the war of wars at the end of the 7-year tribulation. What we're going to do in the next several weeks is look at some major shifts that have happened in our world and in our culture. And today, we're going to begin with socialism. Believe me, this is a scriptural message, not a cultural message. I just want to maintain that. That's the center point here. Paul said there would be hollow and deceptive philosophies that would deceive people. This is one of them. Socialism, communism, Marxism, and what we're experiencing in our nation, cultural Marxism, they are all kissing cousins. And they deceive people with a surprisingly easy. People have been deceived so easily. And the reason that people are deceived so easily is because they do not have a godly foundation by which they can compare it with. Remember, you have the ungodly, empty philosophies of the world, and you have Christ. Yeah. Right? So if you don't have this foundation, you don't have the truth to compare with what is hollow and empty. So they don't, and in large part, what has happened in our world, especially in recently, when people take polls and the people call up and they do these religious polls, and you have the nuns. How many of you know? When I first heard that, I'm going, the nuns, N-U-N-S. There's been nuns in the world a long time, you know, with the Catholic tradition. No, that's not the nuns. If you know what the nuns are, raise your hand. Okay, N-O-N-E-S, the nuns, meaning what? Don't believe in God. Don't believe in God. That statistic has risen dramatically in the last 15 to 20 years. It's risen dramatically. So that's why people can be so easily deceived. If you reject that which is truth, then it's very easy to absorb something that catches your fancy. And one of those things has been socialism. It has invaded the United States. In 2020, get this, in 2020, 40% of Americans had a favorable view of socialism. Here's what's more disturbing. 1 year earlier, it was 4% less. In other words, it grew by 4% between 2019 and 2020. Wow, hardly to see cultural change that fast. Is really incredible. But here's what's even more disturbing. Among the millennials, 47% have a favorable view towards socialism. And among Gen Z, that's the next younger group, your 20-somethings, I think, in high teens, 49% are favorable towards socialism. It doesn't mean that they are socialists. It's not what that Paul is saying. It's saying they're favorable towards the idea of this philosophical point of view because of what is put out there on the surface. So what I'm going to just spend just a moment or two is talking about, where did it come from? Well, it started with a guy by the name of Karl Marx. He wrote the Communist Manifesto. And Karl Marx hated God. He hated God, and he was a cheerleader for the devil. A biographer of his wrote, he had the devil's view of the world and the devil's malignancy. Sometimes, this is what he wrote, sometimes he seemed to know that he was accomplishing works of evil. In many ways, Karl Marx is ruling the world today from his grave. He hated Christianity. He saw it as the source of oppression. He said, religion is the opium of the people. Opium is not a drug that's talked a lot about these years. Our culture is more into, you know, the weed and all that stuff. But it's like this, the thing to make your mind go blank and you feel good. He said, religion is the opium of the people. And this is what he says, loyalty to the church has to be replaced by loyalty to the state. He said, we must drive out the capitalists from the earth, and we must drive out God from heaven. wherever Marxism has dominated, he died in the late 1800s, and Marxism has been adopted in some form or another through the years, but it was adopted by the educational system early on and has been ruminating in our, especially secondary education, through the years, and certain nations have adopted it, and certain individuals have lived by the power of it. I'm talking about people like Stalin and Mao Zedong and Mussolini and the guy in Cuba, whatever his name is, and then ultimately Venezuela is the latest example. And there is not one example. There is not one example where the principles of socialism have been put into place and it's been successful for the people. See, it's put up as this is great for the people. Everybody's going to do good. We're going to share all the resources and everything is going to be great. But what happens is that all the power goes to the government. The people have nothing, and the nations go into complete shambles. The people are poor. One-third of the people, this is the latest example, one-third of the people have left Venezuela because of the Marxism and communism, the socialism that is there. They have got to get out of there because they're dying from the poverty that's there. That's one of the things, that's only one of many, many things that has been the engine towards so many people coming across our own border wanting to get away from the nations that are under the thumb of socialism. So wherever Marxism has dominated, church leaders and followers were murdered in every case, and those who survived were denied civil rights and subjected to economic oppression, and the church is forced to go underground. If we don't have the idea yet, socialism is not a good thing. And it's really a bad thing for the people of faith. Socialism also in its maturity demands totalitarianism. Now that's a big word, but it was summarized in this way: everything within the state, nothing outside of the state, and nothing against the state. In other words, the state controls everything. That's what socialism wants to do: put the government completely in control. Truth is whatever the leaders decide what truth is. Has zero to do with Christ. It's whether they think that they want the truth to be. It demands allegiance to a set of progressive beliefs and compliance that is forced by the states and the elites who form those public opinions. Now, I don't want to lose you here. Stay with me for just another second. Marxism and socialism thrives on division, and this is what we saw happen in 2020. It thrives on division, dividing classes of people, the oppressors against the oppressed, the poor hating the rich, divisions of racism, divisions in sexuality, and now to the four gender confusions. Racist is the modern cry, even when it has nothing to do with racism. This isn't a modern thought or a plan. This is something that has its roots from the very beginning. This is how you disrupt culture. And these are the plans that are being put into place to disrupt culture. It is a hollow and empty philosophy, even though it's powerful, but not nearly like Christ is. All right, now, Marxism is deadly. As I mentioned last week, we talked about the astronomical death toll that has happened. Now, I'm going to just delay that for now, but it just, wherever Marxism happens, it's not death is soon to follow, death follows, period. Christianity, we are about life, right? Jesus is life. He's the light of men. And this form of system is about death. And everywhere you see its ugly fingers go, it's about death. death, except for those in the upper echelons, because they don't care about anyone or anything else. So what we are presently experiencing is called cultural Marxism. That's the term that's floated out there. It's a form of Marxism that's good. That's what's floated out there. It's good because it really does help people. But you know what cultural Marxism leads to? Always, 100% of the time, hardcore Marxism. It's just a step to it. So we see it in the destruction and the tearing down of monuments. If you think the tearing down of those monuments that happened, number one, was an independent action of anything else, you got to know that it's part of the plan. And secondly, it wasn't just teenagers out for a joyride one night and say, hey, let's tear down tear down these monuments. They're wanting to take down the historical foundations of a nation, and that's only one representation of that. There is a concerted effort to attack and erase the past. If you've heard of the 1619 thing, I hope you haven't, but if you have, it's an effort to erase our history. The riots that happened in Washington and in Oregon and in Minnesota and other places, did you not find it interesting, if you were aware of it, how quickly it was organized, how efficiently it was, and how many resources they had? Exactly. It wasn't a fly-by-night thing that happened with local people just getting upset over something that happened. It was a planned attack. We know this because of the amount of resources that the people had. It's planned. Defunding the police goes along with Marxist philosophy to replace this. Here's the purpose. There's a greater purpose than just defunding the police. The larger purpose is take away traditional authority. When you take away the traditional authority, now we can come in with a separate authority. People who live in, who have come from other countries under the thumb of socialism, Marxism, are appalled by what they see happening in the States because they've seen it happen in their own countries. They are seeking to rewrite history, change the textbooks, invent new history so that the nation will eventually forget what it once was and what it is. Now, some people might think that cancel culture is a new phenomenon. It has happened in every culture where Marxism has taken over because there's no room for any dissenting opinions. You can't have free speech. You've just got to agree with what they say the truth is. And we're going to tackle that a lot more deeply here in a few weeks. Something that we do know and something that we have seen and something that we have lamented over the last few years is the dismantling of the nuclear family, right? I mean, they have made great strides in doing so, but this is why. Do you know the why behind it? Here's the why. Karl Marx thought that Judeo-Christian values bred inequality, that it feeds on greed and systemic oppression. In Marxism, husbands are seen as oppressors, and parents are seen as those who suppress their children. And so they say these clusters of oppressions have to be broken up. If you have asked the question in recent days, how can these schools not tell parents what's going on? How can states be pushing children to get these sex change operations without parents' permission? It's crazy. There's a lot of, I'm going to preach Jesus. I'm just wanting to inform on this. They want the current, get this, folks, they want the current system to fail and be replaced. That's been a tough one to get through my thick skull, that people actually want that. How could anybody want that? But when you begin to understand the Marxist point of view, the frame of mind, you understand that they hate the current system and they want anarchy. They want children to not let their parents know, and they don't want parents to know because they want who to control? The state. All right. So again, this isn't a recent plan. This is something that's been working on, they've been working on for years. They've just been able to gain traction, and this is my perception. They've just been able to gain a lot of traction since what happened in 2020. It is demonic because, this is why I know it's demonic. It goes against what Scripture affirms.
That's right.
This is how I know. So this is what Scripture affirms. Getting back to Scripture. Scripture affirms the dignity of work. Scripture affirms those who refuse to work should not eat. Scripture affirms the right to have private property. Scripture confirms, or rather condemns, theft. Scripture condemns covetousness. Scripture affirms saving money. Scripture affirms thrift. Scripture affirms land ownership, Acts chapter 4. And Scripture affirms investments. Now that's just a quick list. But the point is here, Marxism opposes all of those things. You have what the Lord has set up in His Word, truth, and you have the philosophies of the world, empty and demonic. So, spiritually today, this is what's happening. You'll find it in 2 Timothy chapter 3, starting with verse 1. Mark this. There will be terrible times in the last days. Everybody say terrible times. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, and they have a form of godliness but deny its power. Have nothing to do with such people. The Holy Spirit inspired Paul to write. You'll need to take time to go through that list on your own later and compare it to what we see happening in culture. Now, this is what is said in 2 Timothy 3. No. Sorry. I just read 2 Timothy 3. All right. This is what Jesus said. Words of Jesus. This comes out of Matthew 24. As in the days of Noah, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered the ark, and they did not know until the flood came and took them all away, so also will be the coming of the Son of Man. During the days of Noah, God saw the wickedness of man, and he saw that it was so great that every intent of the mind and of the heart was evil continually. And so God had Noah build this ark. Took him 120 years to do it. Peter calls him a preacher of righteousness in 2 Peter. And so for 120 years, Peter preached to these evil people. All these years, how many converts did he have? All he had was his family and the wives that his boys had married. That's all he had. They ignored Noah's preaching for 120 years. So the hard-headedness of the people in Noah's day will be duplicated in the last days of our world's history. A day where ideologies like socialism can sneak in without much attention at all. Everywhere socialism has reigned, it's failed its citizens. It sounds good, it sounds compassionate, but its fruit is disastrous because those in power take full control. So now, question. Will socialism be the dominant political philosophy on earth when the tribulation begins? It's a good question, isn't it? Will that be the dominant philosophy? Well, it seems likely, right? It's tailor-made for the appearance of Christ. It creates global conditions that bring great stress and trouble. It demands a one-world government, which Scripture says will be established in the last days, right? Revelation chapter 13, it describes the Antichrist as a beast that has vast power and authority. The devil has given the beast this authority. He has given the authority to rule over every tribe and people and language and nation, and all the people who belong to this world worship the beast, save a remnant. I wonder who that remnant would be. Those who follow Jesus, right? There are many antichrists in the world today. Anti-God, antichrist, and in a radical way. I mean, it's proactive. They're very active in this. But there is a day coming when the devil is going to empower one person described as a beast that will rule the world. And as we see things now, it could change, but as we see things now, socialism and other totalitarian type governments are custom made for this to be set up, to take place. So, all that sounds kind of depressing, doesn't it? Disheartening. So the question is, what do we do? What can we do? Well, this is why I want to do this series. I'm not going to be able to say it all right now, but I'm going to give a handful of things, all right? Because we need to be prepared and we need to have a positive direction. When everything is falling down around us, we need to have a positive direction, right? So as I'd said, this past Wednesday, we discovered that the fastest growing church in the world is Iran, but this is what you probably don't know. The mosques are empty. The church is growing like wildfire. And the church, the people that are being won to Christ, they love Israel. And they love the land of Israel. Oh, do you think we'll ever hear that on the news? So I urge you, we only watched the first part. This coming Wednesday, we're going to watch the second part, and there is a third part. Come on Wednesday night and learn. This week, we're going to learn about who is doing it and how they're doing it. It's amazing. So, answering the question, what can we do? Number one, keep reviewing what the Bible says. This is where our hope is. Hope is found here. When we say, I believe in Jesus, you know what that means? That also means you believe his words. Okay? If you believe in Jesus, you believe his words. So you got to keep reviewing those. I don't know about you, but I have a good forgetter up here. You know? And the older I get, the more forgetfulness it is. So I need to keep reminding myself. Jesus said, this is the verdict. This is what Jesus said. The verdict is light has come into the world. Whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what he has done has been done through God. Life and light is very visible. Shadows and emptiness and darkness of philosophies is all about deception. Christ is never about deception. It's about This is the truth. Do you want it? This is, I'm never going to show you the truth, but this is what I want you to believe. Right? So keep reviewing what the Bible says. Marxism, by whatever name is used, is no match for the master. I'm telling you. Jesus has gone into heaven, and he is at the right hand of God. Angels and authorities and powers have been made subject to him. That's in 2 Peter. And guess what he's doing right now for you? He is interceding for you. That's why we pray for one another in our service every single week. Because we know the Lord hears our prayers, and he takes our prayers, and he intercedes for us before the Father as a group and as individuals within the group. He is interceding for us. Our daily confidence comes from knowing Jesus and his promises. That's number one. Secondly, what can you do? Refuse to live by lies. There's a day coming when good will be called evil and evil will be called good. Oh, we're there. We're there. Proverbs 29:12, if a ruler pays attention to lies, all his servants become wicked. So much of what we hear these days has no connection to common sense. Have you noticed? No connection to common sense. Just because someone in power says something is true doesn't mean it's true. So we need to be able to discern the times with godly wisdom. How do we get godly wisdom? Well, we know what God has told us, but it also comes prayer in relationship with the Lord as well. Okay? Third, resolve to follow Jesus and not just admire him. This is crucial. Do you believe in Jesus? Yes. Good. I'm going to kill you because I don't. And what they found in Iran is this. If you have converts to Christianity, they'll run away. But if you have disciples and followers of Jesus, they hang in for the long haul because they know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Amen. Resolve to follow Christ and not just admire him. Oh, I think he's a good guy. Oh, I think he was a great prophet. No, no, no. It's more than that. Follow him. What does Jesus want me to do in this situation? Another thing we need to do is to rethink small groups. We've had a really tough time through the years trying to develop small groups in this congregation. I'm just being upfront with you here. We've had a terrible time trying to get them to last and to keep going. They come, they go, but you know, now there's a handful of people that have been coming to our one Sunday school class. We started another one this morning. But this is what we know. This is what we know. The churches that had a robust small group system survived well during the pandemic. Those that did not, did not. And so in the coming days, we need, if you are, first, there's many things. I'm going to cover this later. But if you're in a small group, you are able to have a support system when the large group is not able to gather. And that's huge, especially when the days get worse. It's huge. And so, especially in America, we have this idea of separatism and lone rangerism and me, myself, and I can pull myself by my own, up by my own bootstraps. But when it comes to our faith, Lord, when it comes to our faith, the Lord has designed the church to flourish in groups. Remember, how many times have I read this last several weeks? They went from house to house and the temple courts. Well, if the temple court is taken out by whatever cultural reasons, then you still have the house to house. So we're going to be thinking through that some more. And then next to last is this, resist any way you can. Remember the last couple of weeks we covered Peter and John in Acts chapter 4 before the Sanhedrin. And they said, do not speak in the name of Jesus. And they says, we can't help but speak in the name of Jesus. That chapter, that story, is a great story of how Christians resist the government. If it's against God, then we say, we must obey God rather than man. I mean, that's the foundational rule for Christians. I must obey God and not man. And then last of all, How many of you know what the word Maranatha means? Come, Lord Jesus. Maranatha means come, Lord Jesus. And so the scriptures are filled with look forward to the Lord's coming. Look forward to it. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. And why? Because Isaiah 9 tells us. Isaiah 9 says, and the government will be where? Upon his shoulders. Right? Our Lord Jesus Christ is going to be the one that is in control ultimately. So I've given you a boatload today. There's a lot to think about. It's the scriptures that give us the foundation of our faith, of who Christ is, who he is among us, who he is in us, who he will be through us, and how we are to live in these present days. Let's pray if the worship team would come up. Lord, whatever the philosophical systems of the world may be, and whatever they may choose to push upon people, Lord, we want to be a people that is solidly, firmly attached to you, so that nothing that this world throws at us will shake us. Will shake our faith, will shake our obedience to you. Your scripture warns that those days are coming when people's faith will be shaken. And we pray for one another, Lord, that our faith will never be shaken. In you we pray, Lord. Amen. Let's stand and let's sing to God be the glory. Great things he has done.
To God be the glory. Great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son. His life and atonement for sin, and open the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father. Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice.
feel like you've been blessed today? Amen. Turn to your neighbor. Wait. Don't clap. Turn to your neighbor and say, I've been blessed today. How about you?
I've been blessed today.
How about you?
Now turn to your neighbor again and say, have a blessed week.
Have a blessed week.
All right. Andy's going to lead us in victory in Jesus here.
Okay. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. Heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning, and I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. Cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory! Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Heard about a mansion he had built for me in glory. I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. About the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me victory beneath the cleansing flood. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Amen. God bless everybody. Have a great week.